If you will, this morning, turn in your Bible to 2 Corinthians chapter 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, the last verse of the chapter, Paul writes and says, "Thanks be unto God for His unspeakable gift." Thanks be unto God for His unspeakable gift. We read the word unspeakable and we think, well, that's a gift that you can't speak about or a gift you can't talk about. But the word unspeakable here, and interestingly enough, it's the only time that particular word is used in the way that it's used here. And so thanks be unto God for His unspeakable gift. And it doesn't mean that it cannot be spoken. It has to do with the idea of being indescribable. It's beyond the ability to give a description, define. It's inexpressible. So thanks be unto God for His unspeakable gift. It's the idea that I just can't put it into words. Or words just do not do it justice. We get out here in the mountains and we pull the camera out and you take a picture. And then you look at the picture, and you look at what you see, and the picture just what? It just doesn't captivate it. The picture just doesn't do it justice. Well, it's the same thing that happens when we talk about the gift that God has given us and those gifts that God gives us. We try to put them into words. We express words. We use words because that's how we communicate. But yet we find that this gift is just, we fall short. We never are able to fully give a good expression, a good description, a good definition when we talk about those things. Thanks be unto God for His unspeakable gift. I will reminisce. And you've been around long enough, some of these stories you've heard me tell before, but kind of building a foundation as we carry on. How many of you remember, and it might be something as an adult, but usually it's something that we remember as a kid, but how many of you remember the best Christmas gift or the best gift you ever received? And you think back and, boy, here's a gift, here was a present, whether it was a Christmas gift or a birthday gift, here was a gift that I got. I mean, it was my favorite one of all time. Does anybody have something on your mind about that? I'm not going to call on you to tell it, but does anybody have something comes to their mind? Okay, I see. Yeah, a few hands come up. Well, if you've been around me long enough, you may remember, but I talk about the favorite gift I ever received. I think it was probably about Christmas when I was around 10 years old, I think. And it was a set, I always got a set of holsters, you know, pistols and holsters, cap guns for Christmas. I was that kid that always wanted to be the cowboy. And so I always got a holster and pistols, those kind of things. And one year for Christmas, I got one of those double holster rig cap guns, and it had a buckle on the front of it. And in the buckle was a little Derringer pistol. And if you poked your belly out, the Derringer would swing out from the buckle and shoot plastic bullets. Man. That was the coolest thing for a 10-year-old boy that always wanted to be a cowboy, you know. And you had to have double holsters and spin those things and shoot those caps and poke your belly out and that Derringer would swing out there and shoot those plastic bullets. That was my favorite Christmas gift of all time. It's one of those things you'd have to see it, but you can imagine it in your mind's eye. Probably the worst gift that I ever got, I think my dad got me the holster kit that year. The worst gift I ever got, it was for my birthday. And I think I was probably about 8 years old. And I say it was a worse gift because I was disappointed. It wasn't what I wanted. You know, cowboy, if you're going to be a cowboy, you want cowboy boots. I mean, how can you be a cowboy and not have cowboy boots? I saw Dewey in Cracker Barrel one day, and he didn't have boots on, though, did you? But he had on his tennis shoes. It was this summer. Had on his tennis shoes, had on his shorts, and had his cowboy buckle and belt, and a cowboy shirt on. Oh, he had a polo on. Okay, had a polo on. But he did have his belt and his buckle on.
I remember the shorts.
I won't say anymore. But you know, if you're gonna be a cowboy, you gotta have a pair of cowboy boots, you know, and I'd always wanted cowboy boots. Y'all might remember J.C. Penney used to put out, you know, their catalogs. Maybe they still have one, but they used to have a Western catalog, and it was just cowboy stuff. You remember that? Y'all remember seeing that? And it was, you know, Western clothes and saddles. I mean, just everything Western, and it was just its own little separate catalog put out by J.C. Penney's. And of course, that was my birthday wish book. That was my Christmas wish book. And I'd go through and I'd circle stuff and leave it so my mom could see it. Well, one year I don't know that I'd ever had my own pair of cowboy boots, and I was wanting some cowboy boots. And so, you know, birthday comes around. My mom gives me my birthday present. It's in the right shape. You know, it's cowboy boot box shape. And so I'm excited. So I open it up, and it's a boot box. And I flip the lid open to that box, and it's a pair of boots, but it's not cowboy boots. Do y'all know what Wellingtons are?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's a pair of black Wellington boots. Now you gotta keep in mind, if I'm 8 years old, this is in the mid 60s, you know, and that was back in the day where cowboy boots were, you know, kill a roach in a corner, pointy-toed boots. And, you know, fancy stitching on the toe and fancy stitching on the top, that's cowboy boots. Well, and a big old tall heel, you know, undercut heel cowboy boots. Well, this pair of Wellingtons, plain black boot, round toe, no stitching on the toe, no stitching on the top, and a flat walking heel. Come on, Mom. Yeah. These aren't cowboy boots. And I was disappointed. I'm still disappointed. I can tell. And so, you know, you might have similar stories. You know, those things that you remember that really stand out, whether they're wonderful or whether they're maybe not so wonderful, but those are my two. I'm building here to where we're going. Debbie and I just had our 43rd wedding anniversary on Thursday, and of course, Christmas time.
He's a lucky man.
I'm a lucky man. And I don't have any problem saying that the most wonderful Christmas gift I ever received was Debbie marrying me. Jesus Christ saved my soul, but my wife has been instrumental in saving my life. And y'all know what I mean when I say that. I mean, she's just been a rock for me through these years. So again, Christmas gifts. I don't know if Christmas gift is the right way to say that, but she was a gift to me from God. Whoso findeth a wife findeth good thing and obtaineth favor from the Lord. And Deb's always been that for me. And so I had to throw that in there because it's that season and that's an important thing. But as we walk here through here and spend a little time, we're going to talk about, and we're going to try to do what we're told we can't do. This indescribable, can't put it into words, gift that we have, and yet we do have some things that we can look at that I think will be a help to us. And because after all, when we get through with the manger scenes, and we get through with the Christmas trees, and get through with all the Christmas meals and Christmas desserts and the festivities and the family time, the time with friends and the gifts, and all that is said and done and put away, you know, what Christmas is supposed to be about is the coming of Christ and the greatest gift of all. And of course we know that it's His death on that cross for our sins, His burial and resurrection for our justification, but that couldn't have happened if Jesus had not taken upon Himself the form of a man and become obedient unto death. We go back to John chapter 21, if you'll turn back to your left a little bit, a few chapters, a few pages. It's the last chapter of the book of John. Again, as we're building on this idea of this unspeakable, indescribable, difficult to put into words, gift. John chapter 21, as he comes to the end of his gospel, or the letter that this epistle that he wrote, this gospel of John, he comes down to the very last verse, verse 25 of John chapter 21, and he says that there are also many other things which Jesus did, the which, if they should be written, every one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that should be written. Amen. Well, that's a broad stroke. That's a broad paintbrush right there. So John says, I've done my best. And of course, we know he did it under inspiration of the Holy Spirit of God. He says, I've written this thing, and I've written about Jesus, and I've written what I've been given to write about Jesus, but he comes back and says there were so many other things that he did during the three and a half years of his ministry, and of course 33 and a half years of his life, that if every one of the things that Jesus had done should be written, that even the world itself couldn't contain all the books. That's kind of an idea of unspeakable, isn't it? I mean, it's just, the story couldn't be told of everything that could have been told about the life of Jesus in his ministry to Israel. Paul, in the book of Ephesians, back over to your right, keep turning there, Romans, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, chapter 3, Ephesians chapter 3. We're going to read verses 14 through 21, then drop back in on 19 and 20. Ephesians chapter 3, 19 and 20 specifically, but let's read 14 through 21. Paul says, "For this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant unto you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen." So this is one of those prayers of Paul as he prays for the Ephesians. Verse 14, "For this cause I bow my knees." But then at verse 19 and 20 again, he says, "And to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge." Well, there again is that idea of unspeakable. It's just the love of Christ. We know the love of Christ. We know that God commendeth his love toward us, and that while we're yet sinners, Christ died for us. We read about the love of Christ. We know how much he loves us, that he laid down his life and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. But as Paul writes it, he talks about knowing the love of Christ which passeth knowledge. It's just it's just beyond our ability to understand at some point. Verse 20, where he says, "Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think." Again, there's that idea of unsearchable, exceeding abundantly above all that we would ever ask or ever think. It's just beyond description, unsearchable. Well, go with me back to your left again to Romans chapter 5. Probably more is said about the gift than in Romans 5 than anywhere else. I'm turning too far. We're just going to hit some high spots as we walk through here. This is not going to be a great doctrinal exegesis by any means, but it's just talking about the gift. And so, whereas in Romans chapter 5, and for time's sake, we're just going to drop in at verse 12. We're going to read 12 through 21. It's hard for me to go to Romans 5, as you know, and not pick up in Romans 4 and walk our way through. But we won't today. But we're just going to pick up at verse 12 and read through verse 21. Romans 5. "Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed when there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after similitude of Adam's transgression, who is the figure of him that was to come. But not as the offense, so also is the free gift. For if through the offense of one many be dead, much more the grace of God and the gift by grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, hath abounded unto many. And not as it was by one that sinned, so is the gift. For the judgment was by one to condemnation, but the free gift is of many offenses unto justification. For by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. Therefore, as by the offense of one, judgment came upon all men to condemnation, even so by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. For as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. Moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound, but where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. That as sin hath reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord." So as we go down through here, I'm not going to dissect and give a full deep explanation of everything through here. I'm just going to pull some thoughts out about this unspeakable gift. Verse 14, first of all, tells us that this gift comes by grace. Romans 5:15, "Much more the grace of God and the gift by grace." How do we receive this gift of God? We receive it completely and totally by His grace. Well, if we receive it completely and totally by His grace, what does that mean? It means we can't earn it. It's not by any merit of our own. He made all the provision. He took care of all the sacrifice. He took all of our sin upon Himself. He bore that sin, paid the price for that sin, carried that body of sin down to the depths of hell, and yet came out victorious over death, hell, and the grave. That rose again the third day. And so when we look at how that gift comes, it comes by grace. You can't do anything to attain it. We can't do anything to earn it. It's simply, completely, and totally by the grace of God. The gift by grace. Well, that's good news. And even when we put that back in our context of the unspeakable gift, do you understand how hard it is for churchianity to get a hold of the idea of the gift is completely and totally by grace? even when you hear folks talk about salvation by grace and you really start drilling them and asking them questions and talking to them, they eventually end up throwing in there, yeah, it's by grace, but you got to do this or you got to do that or you got to do the other. Folks, the gift is by grace. It's all provided by Him, and all we do is believe. It's by His grace. You can't earn it. You don't deserve it. You just trust Him because He provided it for you. Notice again in verse 15 that the gift comes by one man, Jesus Christ. Much more, the grace of God and the gift by grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, hath abounded unto many. We like to quote John 14 in verse 6, where Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh to the Father but by me. And that was true as He told it to the apostles, as He was preparing them for His death and all that. But it's also true for us today. There is no way to go to the Father except through Jesus Christ. Not just Jesus Christ as the Son of God, as it was for the apostles, but by Jesus Christ, the sinless Son of God, who died for our sins, was buried and raised for our justification. There's only one way. And that gift comes by that one man, Jesus Christ. It doesn't come by church, it doesn't come by preacher, it doesn't come by anything else. It comes by one man, Jesus Christ, and what He accomplished on our behalf on that cross. As we look at verse 16 and verse 18, it tells us that this free gift is unto justification. Look at the last part of verse 16. For the judgment was by one to condemnation, but the free gift is of many offenses unto justification. Verse 18 says, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life, there at verse 18. And so it's the gift comes by grace. The gift comes by one man, Jesus Christ. And it's a free gift that brings us unto justification. Just like the end of Romans 4 says, He was delivered for our offenses and was raised again for our justification. Now again, when we start talking about being unspeakable, beyond words, the idea as we ponder who we are before a holy and righteous God, as we ponder our sins, we ponder the nature of who and what we are, the idea that we can freely, by His grace, because of His work, simply when we believe, can be declared justified. That's a big deal. To be declared justified. Well, we know we're not just. We know that there's nothing that we can do in the effort of our own flesh to attain or to deserve or to earn justification. But when we realize that we're sinners and can't save ourselves, and we come to faith in Christ by grace, that Jesus is the way, and what He accomplished when He died for our sins, was buried and raised again for our justification, and we come to faith in that, and we realize that because of the righteousness of Christ imputed or credited to our account, God the Father drops that gavel down on that judgment desk, and He says, I declare that one who's trusting My Son for their salvation as justified. That's a gift. All these things, when we talk about gifts, gifts are something that are offered that you just receive. You don't earn them. If you worked for it, it's a wage. But if it's just given to you as a gift, all you have to do is receive it. The gift of justification. Verse 17 of Romans chapter 5, as we continue right there, he says, for by one man's offense, death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one. So within this context, not only do we have the gift that comes by grace and the gift that comes by one man, Jesus Christ, not only is it a free gift unto justification, but it's the gift of righteousness. He declares us justified because of the work of His Son who paid the debt. And then He declares us righteous, the gift of righteousness. And again, is that our righteousness? No, but it's the righteousness of His Son. we read the thing, we've studied it through many times. It's that big word, you know, imputation. In other words, the righteousness of Christ is credited to or placed upon our account. And that gift of righteousness. And indeed, it is a gift. Look across the page at Romans chapter 6. Look at the last verse of Romans chapter 6. Verse 23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And so this thing just continues to build. This gift comes by grace. It comes by one man, Jesus Christ. It's a free gift unto justification. It's a gift of righteousness. And this gift provides to us eternal life. Eternal life. That means that the moment you realize you're a sinner, the moment we have realized we're sinners, the moment we've trusted Christ as our Savior, that moment we receive eternal life. We get all that by grace, through faith, and the finished work, that one man. He declares us justified. He imputes to us the righteousness of Christ. And with all that comes eternal life. You don't have to wait till you die to get eternal life. You have eternal life now. You have eternal life in Christ now. In Adam, all die, but in Christ, all are made alive. And so the moment we trust Christ, we're made alive in Him. We come out of our death and our deadness in Adam, and we're quickened and made alive and come to spiritual life and have therefore eternal life in Christ the moment we believe. The wages of sin is death. That's the wages of Adam's sin that we inherit. But the gift of God, when we come to faith in Christ and what He accomplished on our behalf, is He eternal life. So we have that. Ephesians chapter 2. Keep turning to your right. Ephesians chapter 2. Again, familiar places to us. I've gone through and had several references in the book of Ephesians, and in my notes, yeah, I've got written the whole chapter. And so, you know, don't have time to read the whole chapter, but the whole chapter fits the context and tells the story. And so this is one of those things you go home and over the next few days maybe spend some time in the book of Ephesians. You get into Ephesians chapter 2, and we just for time's sake drop in at verses 8 and 9. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. Most of us can quote these two verses. If not, it's familiar to us anyway. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And so we've got grace. We've got the gift by grace. We've got the gift comes by one man. We've got a free gift unto justification. It's the gift of righteousness. It's the gift of eternal life. It's the gift of salvation. Now, when we think about salvation and we think about eternal salvation, we think about a future salvation in that sense. Of course, we're saved by grace now, are we not? But with that salvation comes a couple of deliverances, a couple of salvations as even we look for the future. One of those salvations is we have been delivered from the wrath to come. You know, you go search through the movie channels and trying to find a movie, and I think it was on Netflix or something, there was a movie came up. What was that movie with Sandra Bullock? What was that called? Do you remember what it was called?
Bird something.
What?
Bird something. Bird Box.
The Bird Box. Anybody ever seen the movie The Bird Box? You seen it? We started watching it for just a few minutes and said, man, this thing is weird. And it's some kind of apocalyptic kind of thing. They got to wear blindfolds, and if they look and see these things, it'll, I mean, people all over the world are committing suicide and doing all kind of, I mean, we watched just enough of it to get the kind of a gist of where it was going. And Sandra Bullock has two kids, and she puts blindfolds on them, and she says, it doesn't matter what you hear, it doesn't matter what you, you know, feel, it doesn't matter, don't take them blindfolds off. And if anybody took the blindfolds off, all kind of horrible things. Apocalyptic movies. You got, you know, we got, what are these, some of these two, the Dead Men Walking or something? What?
Walking Dead.
The Walking Dead, you know. You see, I'm not. All these kind of things, apocalyptic movies. And you know, people watch that stuff, and have you ever heard of preppers?
Yeah.
What's the whole concept behind preppers? Well, they're being prepared, but what are they preparing for?
Apocalypse.
An apocalypse. They're preparing for an apocalypse. They're preparing for nuclear disaster. They're preparing for, you know, all kind of stuff taking place. And I need to have a bunker and food to last for months and ammunition and weapons. And I'm worried about all that. There's a lot of fear about those apocalyptic kind of things. I've got a customer. He moved into a house up in Parrotsville somewhere, and he bought that house, and the old man that had it was a Vietnam vet, and the guy said that the longer he lives there, the more stuff he finds. This guy had places he buried barrels all over his property, and in those barrels, you know, he's got a spot here, and in these barrels he's got food and you know, water and weapons, and he's got several barrels, and they're buried here, and got all that stuff in it. You go to another place, he's got the same thing, and he did that all over his property. This guy says, I'm still uncovering stuff. Worried about some future apocalypse. Folks, I'm telling you, it's coming, but I'm not worried about it. We ain't gonna be here. I mean, the church is caught up to be with the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. And then, you know, Jesus stands and he starts opening that seven seal book, Revelation chapter 5, and those seven seals start getting opened, and all that wrath starts getting poured out upon this earth. But folks, we're not going to be here. Now, there's going to be family, maybe loved ones, and folks who are going to be left behind who's never trusted Christ. But we're not going to be here. I'm not worried about the apocalypse. You shouldn't be either. And so when he tells us in Ephesians 2, 8, and 9, for by grace are you saved through faith, that not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. This grace, this gift of grace that brings salvation, it's salvation from the tribulation, from the 70th week of Daniel, from the time of Jacob's trouble. We don't have to worry about the wrath and being down here when the wrath of God is poured out. Salvation. We don't have to worry about the great white throne of judgment when the books are open back there in Revelation, what is it, 20:21. The books are open and they're looking for the... Folks, if we're there, we're there observing, because everything that has to do with that was taken care of for us at Calvary's cross. Well, I'm not worried about the great white throne of judgment. I'm not worried about whose names were not found in the book of life or cast into the lake of fire. Salvation. We have been saved by His grace. For by grace are you saved. Well, saved from what? Saved from the wrath to come. Saved from the lake of fire. We've been saved. That's a gift. That salvation, that gift comes by grace. It comes by one man. That gift brings justification. That gift brings righteousness. That gift brings eternal life. That gift brings salvation. Look across the page or turn the page to Ephesians chapter 3. Again, I've got the, you know, verses 1 through 21. I got the whole thing there. But just drop in at verse 7 and 8. Paul writing here says, whereof I was made a minister according to the gift of the grace of God, given unto me by the effectual working of His power, unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ? Well, we know that this gift of salvation, all that's entailed, and again, if we sat down and we tried to talk about and really put into words and describe all that our salvation has for us, I think we're going to fall short every time. Don't you? I mean, we can read it, we can understand the doctrinal truth of it, but I think when we try to describe it, we're going to find it's unspeakable. How can I put a description on the salvation that we have in Christ? That's tough. But we go on here, and we're in Ephesians 3, and Paul talks about this gift. Well, it goes on then beyond salvation, because Paul talks about this grace that was given unto him, this gift of the grace of God given unto him, which we know he gave to us. Look at verse 1 of chapter 3. For this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for ye Gentiles, if ye have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which is given me to you. So when we talk about gift, and we talk about an unspeakable gift, not only are we talking about that salvation and what we have in Christ, but we're also talking about that body of truth. God gave to us the gift of Paul. God gave to us an apostle and gave to that apostle a body of truth. And that is indeed a gift. When we stop and consider, as we study our Bibles rightly divided, we learn the things that we learn that are specific and unique to us today in this dispensation of the grace of God. We learn those from our Apostle Paul. That's a gift. And Paul tells us that it's a gift of grace given to him. Look across the page at chapter 4, dropping at verse 7. Well, I do need to read a little bit walking into that. Let's start at verse 1. Ephesians 4, 1. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, even as ye are called, and one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Unto verse 7 again, unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Well, this is kind of taking hand in glove together. We have our salvation and all that we have in Christ when He saved us by His grace and all those things we've been talking about there. We have that body of truth that's given to us from the ascended Lord Jesus Christ through our Apostle Paul. And you put all that together and you come into verse 7, but unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Well, how much grace do we have? It's according to the measure of what? The gift of Christ. I mean, as much grace as Christ has, we have. And whatever difficulty, whatever struggle, whatever trial, whatever problem of life, do you think that Christ Himself has enough grace to get us through it? Certainly so. So that's where He says, but unto every man, one of us is... And He talks about our unity and that spiritual working together that He talks about in the first part of that, verse 3, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. He talks about the one body, one Spirit, one hope, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all. And then He comes in verse 7, but unto every one of us, unto each individual one of us, is this grace given according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Does it seem that some people struggle to have more difficulties than others? Sure. I mean, we all have our battles, right? I've never had cancer. I've never had a child with cancer. But we've got folks in this room that have had cancer and have a child with cancer. I've never had a child or a grandchild get seriously life-altering injured in a car accident. I've not had that. I've never had one of my children die as a baby or as a small child. I've never had that. I've not lost a spouse. We could go on and on, couldn't we? But when we know the Lord, I'm still looking around. While I have nieces and nephews and other family members outside of my immediate family, I don't have any right now. The youngest ones are, 11 and 12. But right now, I don't have any children or grandchildren that has ever been in jail. But I'm hitting things that folks in this room have dealt with or are dealing with this morning. Right? But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. What did Paul find? What Paul said when he had that thorn in the flesh and he sought the Lord three times, and what the Lord tell him? My grace is sufficient. What does that mean? That means those of us who've been saved by grace, who understand have some understanding of this body of truth that's delivered to us from our Apostle Paul, and as we walk and live in this life, knowing the grace of God, that means no matter what difficulty, no matter what struggle, no matter what trial, no matter what problem that we might face, when we get there, we will find sufficient grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Isn't that comforting? We might say, I do that. I mean, I see y'all and I look and I think they've gone through this, they're going through that, they're going through this, and I haven't experienced that. And at the same time, I've experienced things that y'all haven't experienced. And as we look and consider those things, we come back and say, thank God that His grace is sufficient to meet the need of that life. Amen?
Amen.
Gives us a lot of comfort. Grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Turn on to the right to 2 Timothy chapter 1. 2 Timothy chapter 1. Again, this is one of those, I've got the whole chapter written down here, but we're just going to drop in at verse 6. 2 Timothy 1, verse 6. Wherefore, Paul writing to Timothy, of course, wherefore I put thee in remembrance that thou stir up the gift of God which is in thee by the putting on of my hands. Go ahead and read verse. Oh, man. Go ahead and read verse 7 and 8, okay? For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me his prisoner, but be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God. And I'm going to stop there, because if I read more, I want to say more. But right there at verse 6, wherefore I put thee in remembrance that thou stir up the gift of God which is in thee by the putting on of my hands. Paul writing to Timothy, and Paul talking about, Paul had an influence. Paul took Timothy under his wing. If there was anyone that was kind of, again, we've talked about, Moses and then Joshua, and you had Elijah and Elisha. Well, you've got Paul and you've got Timothy. And so Paul had taken Timothy under his wing. Paul had taught Timothy. Paul had instructed Timothy. And it was to Timothy that was to hold on to those truths that the ascended Lord Jesus Christ gave to Paul, that Paul passed on to Timothy. And Timothy was to teach and pass on to others. Look at chapter 2 and verse 1 of 2 Timothy. Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. And so that's this gift of God that was given through Paul to Timothy. And then by virtue of just time and so on, it's given from Christ to Paul, to Timothy, to others, and now you and I are sitting here today. And isn't it a gift to know and understand the word of truth rightly divided? Isn't that a gift? I mean, to be able to open our Bible and know that God told different people different things at different times, that's a gift. Man, the confusion that's taken away when we understand just some basic principles of time past, but now, and ages to come. Just some basic principles of the 12 apostles to Israel and the one apostle to the body of Christ, and so on and so forth. All of these things are gifts. Now, do you think this list is exhaustive? No way, is it? We could spend another hour. We could spend the rest of the afternoon. We could go home, spend the night, come back tomorrow and continue to talk about gifts and the gifts of God and all that we have in Christ. Do you think we'd ever get it all said? Which takes us right back to where we started, 2 Corinthians 9:15. Thanks be unto God for His unspeakable gift. Hopefully we've scratched the surface a little bit and we've talked a little bit about some gifts. I'm going to read a little something for you. I'm just going to go through a list. This list is who we are in Christ. And I'm not even going to give all every one of these things I'm going to say has a reference to it. But I'm just going to give the list and walk through it. It's all scripturally supported. Who we are in Christ. Here's gift. We are redeemed. We are new creatures. We're called to be saints. We're accepted in the Beloved. We have the forgiveness of sins. We are more than conquerors. We are ambassadors for Christ. We are justified freely by His grace. We are the temple of the living God, and we have redemption through His blood. We have now received the atonement. We are free from the law of sin and death. We are sons and heirs of God through Christ. We have been given the ministry of reconciliation. We are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ. We are not our own, for we are bought with a price. We are not far, but now made nigh by the blood of Christ. We are sealed by the Holy Spirit unto the day of redemption. We can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth us. We are risen with Him through the faith of the operation of God. We are justified by faith without the deeds of the law. We are justified by His blood. We shall be saved from wrath through Him. We are to endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. We are to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery. We are presented holy, unblameable, and unreprovable in His sight. We're blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. We are justified by His grace and made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. We are to wait for the Lord Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come. We are confident that He which hath begun a good work in us will perform it. We are saved by grace through faith and not of works, lest any man should boast. We are crucified with Christ, nevertheless we live, yet not us, but Christ liveth in us. We are workmen that need not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. We are washed, sanctified, and justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. We are looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ. We are persuaded that nothing shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ. We're justified by the faith of Christ and not by the works of the law, for by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. But thanks be unto God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ, and we are complete in Him. That's a pretty nice little list right there. The gift. the unspeakable or the unsearchable gift. Now, we're going to leave here and we're going to go about our ways. And we're going to open up a gift here and we're going to open up a gift there. We're going to open up some gifts and we're going to look and say, oh wow, underwear. And we're going to say, I needed underwear.
Yeah, I had some really cool socks yesterday.
And so we're going to open up some gifts and we're going to be grateful and thankful for all of them, right? Because we're supposed to be. I am thankful to have a pair of boots, even though they were just stinking Wellingtons. We're going to be thankful. We're going to be thankful that somebody thought enough of us to give us a gift, right? But then we're going to open up a gift and we're going to go, wow, what a gift. And some are going to get through and think, well, you know, I really wanted this gift or that gift and I thought I left enough hints, but I didn't get that one, so I guess I just have to go get it for myself. Isn't that what we do? I mean, that's what people do. And of course, then we get real pious and real spiritual and come back and you say, you know, Brother Sam, for me it's just not about getting gifts, it's all about giving the gifts. And I understand that. The joy of seeing the kids and the grandkids get a little something that they really enjoy and appreciate and are grateful for. And yes, that's certainly true. But I'll just tell you, I'm calm enough, I like getting gifts too. And I suspect most of us do, you know. So when we go through all of that stuff and enjoy all that stuff and appreciate all that stuff over the next several days, let's not forget about thanks be unto God for His unspeakable gift, the gift of salvation, all that we have in Christ, the gift of our apostle, the gift of that body of truth, the gift that we have been given that and have the opportunity to share that with others. Let's be thankful and be grateful for the unspeakable gift. Amen. I hope this has been a help to us today, a little encouragement to you. There it is. Let's have a word of prayer. We'll sing our song. And then we'll make our way.
Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies with angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the new.